Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the 18th meeting of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee for 2023. The first item on the agenda is we have consideration as to whether to take items 4 and 5 in private. Item 4 is a consideration of the evidence we will hear under agenda item 2. And agenda item 5 is the consideration of our draft annual report. Are we agreed to take both these items in private? We are agreed. We'll then move on to the second item on the agenda, which is an evidence session following our inquiry into the role of local government and its cross-sectorial partners in financing delivering a net zero Scotland. The committee reported to the Parliament in January after a major inquiry lasting over a year, ranging over a variety of issues relevant to local government. On the 14th of March, we held a debate in Parliament to highlight the conclusions of the inquiry. We received a response from the government on the 20th of April and agreed to invite back COSLA and their partners in sustainable local governments to share their views on the response and the way forward. I'm therefore pleased to welcome Councillor Gail McGregor from COSLA, the Environment and Economies spokesperson and the leader for Dumfries and Galloway Council. David Hammond, the representative for Solus, the head of Sustainability, Corporate Property and Transport for North Ayrshire Council, and George Tarvitt, the director for Sustainable Scotland Network, and Silke Isbrand, the policy manager for the Environment and Economy team from COSLA, who unfortunately, due to an accident at the weekend, is joining us remotely this morning. I hope you are fully recovered and I wouldn't say fighting fit, but fit for the session this morning. Thank you, all of you, for accepting our invitation. We're delighted to have you here. But before we begin, Councillor McGregor, I think you wish to make a short opening statement.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you very much for the invitation today. It's lovely to see all of you, well, most of you that I've seen before again. I was going to do a short opening statement, but I'm really keen to hear from members, so I will keep it very short. And I think the key thing for us today, I'm delighted to have David, George and Silke with me, because they'll bring the expertise and the sort of detailed knowledge that I think you'll need to hear. I can give you the political element, but I very much rely on them to give you the information that you'll require. And I think for us today, it's how we can collectively capitalise on the report and how local and Scottish Government will work together in achieving our goals. The Environment and Economy Board at COSLA is absolutely behind this agenda. We have a very enthusiastic 32 cohort of representatives from all councils, and I think it's fair to say that I've never seen such an enthusiastic bunch who contribute brilliantly and will be able to bring some of their views and thoughts to your committee in the future as well. But as I say, I think the key thing here today is just to reinforce our commitment to our just transition to net zero, that we need to have a very frank conversation today about what we can do as local government, what we expect Scottish Government to do, and all parties across the Chamber and all partners across Scotland. This is a massive agenda. We only have, well, less than 7 years now to get to 2030. It's an enormous hill for us all to climb. So I'm really happy to be here today. Be kind to me, and I will defer to my very brilliant experts when needed. But thank you.
Thank you very much, Gail. And before we get any further, I'm just going to check if there's any declarations of interest. Yes, Jackie.
Thank you, Convener. Just to refer members to my register of interests, because I was a local councillor up until May last year, and it is on my register of interests.
Okay, thank you very much for that. And so the first questions are actually going to come from me, Gail. And I want to quote back, if I may, something that you said, or some words that you said. It says, "This report by the Committee on the Just Transition to a Net Zero Economy is potentially a watershed moment for Scotland in tackling climate change." You then went on to say, "The report is clear that Scotland will not meet its ambitious climate targets without a more empowered local government." Do you want to just start off by fleshing out those two sentences for us?
Yeah, I think we all understand the challenge that we have ahead of us. I think up till now, we've been tinkering around the edges. If I'm going to be very unsubtle here, we have a lot of good initiatives. We have cabinet secretaries, we have ministers sitting within an enormous portfolio. And what I'm not seeing at the moment all the time is that intertwining between individual areas that are going to get us to that just transition to net zero. So as an example, I'm dealing with 6-7, as I say, ministers or cabinet secretaries. They all have elements of this portfolio. How do we get them to link together and then us to link together with them? So I think we have a massive challenge where we need to see more coordination, active travel working in conjunction with transport, working in conjunction with infrastructure. There's massive challenges. And until we can get that strategic overview much clearer in Scottish Government and the Parliament's mind, we don't really know what we need to do to help you deliver that. So we can do things at local level, we can bring in initiatives, we've had a lot of bid funds, for example, where individual councils can bid in for individual projects, but that's not looking at the problem in its totality. And I think what we've very clearly said from day one is that we need a fully costed roadmap, which is co-produced between us, Scottish Government, wider partners across Scotland, and it needs to be a very clear roadmap with timelines and direction. And I think until we get that absolute certainty around what we're all doing, we're just going to continue to tinker around the edges, and that is not going to achieve the goals that I think we need to achieve.
Okay, I think that's well put. Just explain to me as well how you're getting on with the Scottish Government on the new deal for local authorities. You can tell us all.
I think we're making really good progress. I, as you know, have good relationships, I hope, with ministers and cabinet secretaries. We've obviously had a change. I think I've seen a bit of invigoration with the new minister, Mary McCallan, and a bit more direction, if I'm being honest. I think she's brought a real glow to the portfolio and a clear understanding of what's required. But now we all have to walk the walk. So I think that the relationships are good, but what is very clear to me is that whenever we're doing things, it has to be in co-production. It cannot be them dictating to us what we need to be doing, because then we simply won't achieve our outcomes.
Okay, and I mean, I'm going to ask this question. The report came up with a lot of recommendations. How much money is it all going to cost? Have you worked that out? And what sort of if it's going to cost more money than you're getting at the moment, do you have an idea of a percentage increase that you think you'll need in the budget to start delivering on the things that you've been asked to do?
I'll defer to David or Silke possibly on that. I think clearly it has to be fully costed and it has to be fully funded. The only thing that will prevent the ambition is insufficient funding. But I don't know if David, if you know.
Yeah. Happy to, Councillor McGregor, and thank you for the question, Convener. And I recall at a previous meeting of this committee, a similar question coming up around that cost, which really is, if you'll forgive the pun, the million-dollar question. And I think across the local government family, insofar as the public sector goes, that local authorities are now starting to grasp that nettle, to articulate what is involved. So speaking for my own authority, we have now clarified and quantified the costs that are involved with decarbonising our fleet, so our public sector fleet within the council. And we have a figure around that. We're also undertaking work actively at the moment to do the same piece of work across our property estate, and we will have an answer to that question over the summer. And other local authorities are at varying stages of being able to quantify that gap as it exists at the moment. And I think then, as that information crystallises, it will be really important to link back to what Councillor McGregor talked about in terms of that roadmap and that co-production, so that we can feed in that information to that roadmap and share with Scottish Government colleagues the scale of the task, the nature of the investment required, and also get into a conversation about how we fund that, including leveraging in private investment and working with other partners like the Scottish National Investment Bank and Scottish Futures Trust to help brokerage innovative solutions.
I mean, just on that, I mean, I did some figures across Highland and you know, 60% of their houses don't meet EPCC standards. So if you do back of a fact packet calculation, which I'm not in favour of, but it comes up with about 350 million to get those houses that are below EPCC up to EPCC, which is a huge cost. And if you put that out across the whole of Scotland and all the local authorities, the costs are going to be eye-watering. And I think it's, from the committee's point of view, it's keeping a handle on that. So do you think, Gail, that COSLA will be able to give us an indication of the cost, so we know the size of the problem? You can't fix it till you know the size of it, surely.
I'm not entirely sure it's entirely down to local government to establish the cost of a just transition to net zero. We've got lots of other partners that are involved. There's also the private sector involved. We have councils that no longer have housing stock, so that will be a problem for some councils but not for others, and the problem will pass to social landlords in those local authority areas. But I think what we can do as local government is establish around fleet, around our own estate, around our schools and our buildings, all the things that we have control over or can help and facilitate communities with, such as EV charging points, we can probably do a fairly reasonable assessment of what the totality is going to cost. But when we start to look at transport and infrastructure and active travel and all the other areas that do need to be covered to achieve this, some of that will sit out with our remit. So I think our role is to give you a reality of what it's going to cost to local government, and then Scottish Government can work with us to deliver at our end, but we're all going to have to work together with other partners to achieve that. I don't know, George, if you want to say a bit more globally.
I think... It's fair to say more work needs to be done in this space. I think part of it relates to the clarity around the route map. So certainly in the COSLA comment on the NetZet committee report and the Scottish Government's response to that is still this call for clarity in terms of what are the delivery route maps around these different areas. Then you've got the cost structure. We definitely need to do more work in that space. I think the other thing that the SSN is aware of is how do we make better use of existing resources. So I think the political leadership, the corporate leadership, so we're actually taking the existing resources within the public sector and aligning them to the outcomes that we're trying to achieve will take us some distance on that journey. But it's fair to say further work needs to be done. We're doing a little bit of research at the moment through the SSN membership to pool the information in terms of what studies are being done by colleagues like David across the 32. Happy to share that in due course.
Okay. I think the Deputy Convener wants to come in. Fiona.
Thank you very much for joining us today, and respecting clearly the independence of local authorities, the role of the committee was to try and bring together suggestions that would be helpful for both the Scottish Government but also local councils. One of the clear points that came out is not going to be all about public sector funding. It's going to have to also leverage in private sector funding. But the scale of that is enormous. And for smaller local authorities, for example, like maybe Dumfries and Galloway, even your offer, even for the big infrastructure issues and housing and transport, might not be collectively big enough necessarily to be attractive for financial investment. The Scottish National Investment Bank won't be able to work directly with you until they have a number of the market authority approvals. So therefore, what steps do you think have taken place recently to help mobilise this? How plugged in are you with the Green Finance Task Force in order to make sure that you're going to be well placed to access the private sector funding, which will be billions that will need to be invested, we know that, but to do it in a sensible and place-based approach?
I think the challenge with private sector is that they will follow the money. We know that. Now, as you say, that there will be parts of Scotland where it's very lucrative for them to do that. I think one of the biggest challenges we probably have in smaller rural areas like Dumfries and Galloway or Moray or Argyll and Bute is skills. And capacity within local authorities to be able to work with partners. South of Scotland Enterprise, we're very lucky in the South of Scotland to have them. They have an expert within their workforce now that is very focused on net zero and is looking at businesses that can come into the region, and we'll work closely with them. But I do think that until we can improve the skills and the capacity within some councils, we're going to see a wee bit of a lag. There'll be other authorities that have got plenty of skill and plenty of capacity, but bringing in that private sector investment is not just going to be about the conversations that we have. That's going to have to come, I think, from government and other areas as well.
Can I just ask maybe David, from the officer's point of view, is there a building up of skills and capacity in the financial investment area within local authorities?
I think, Deputy Convener, that's at early stages. As Councillor McGregor's outlined, there is definitely a skills shortage across local government in terms of the climate change sector, and that is building, but it's building slowly, and certainly we want to reach out and work with education partners about how we build that kind of talent pipeline across all matters, not just finance, but technology, for example, as well. And turning to the other part of your question, Deputy Convener, which I think is an important point about the varying sizes of local authority and the role of public sector emissions. For me, it's about scale, and it's about scaling up and how we work in partnership across authorities to build up a package that's attractive for investment, whether that be across council housing stock or indeed working in partnership with RSLs, again, as Councillor McGregor outlined, around decarbonising heat, but also working with other partners to leverage in private sector funding. And I think when I've addressed the committee previously, I drew upon the example of EV, electric vehicle charging infrastructure, and a partnership project across three Ayrshire authorities, where that's exactly it, Deputy Convener. We've tried to work together to package up investment proposition for the private sector to come in and invest in, and that's progressing at the moment, and it's that kind of learning that we'd like to scale up and replicate across the country.
And can I just, in looking at the kind of the wider parameters of our report and causes response, what was the response from your 32 colleagues about the suggestion that councils weren't just responsible for their own properties or their own fleet, but they were well placed to coordinate a place-based response that would actually be about coordinating sectors that weren't part of your direct responsibility, but you were really well placed to help facilitate that kind of climate change response on a place-based approach?
I think, Deputy Convener, that's a fair assessment in the sense that local government is absolutely, again, as I think we've previously outlined, more than happy to play a role locally. We understand we're the delivery arm for decarbonisation, and that we provide leadership locally across a number of sectors, including local business, for example. I think there is a challenge, though, in resource, again, in terms of our ability to do that. Our resources are limited, and reaching out and working in partnership and forging new relationships and identifying new projects to work cross-sector with, for example, again, private industry to undertake a decarbonisation project, that's going to take additional resources and expertise as well. And that is another dimension to the challenge that faces us that we're not currently funded for.
Just before we move on, I think Silke wanted to add to that. So if you want to come in now.
Thank you very much, Convener, and Deputy Convener, both for your questions, and absolutely supporting 100% of what has been said. I think wanted to add in terms of the two issues that have been put forward, your question of, you know, how much to which extent can COSLA sort of like cost the size of the challenge. I think it's really fair to say that a lot of work is going on right now, and your report has really shifted some significant ground here. A lot of work is going on in terms of starting to cost individual pieces, individual envelopes. But what is absolutely required, and this goes back to what Councillor McGregor said earlier on, what is absolutely required is for that to be pulled together so that we get, and that you as a committee get, that clarity of what the sort of price tag overall might be. And unless we pull this all together, we can also not fully establish the potential co-benefits, also the potential conflicts that we have. So as an overall view, I think a lot of work is going on, but we do need this one roadmap, this overview of the whole picture of how this major economic transformation is going to happen. And on the back of the area-based sort of like activities, I think, you know, David Hammond is completely right. There are a number of councils who have absolutely formulated that ambition because because councils are realising that that is possibly some of the biggest impact they can have, is to take that steering role at the local level and to have that political drive. But it is also absolutely correct that, you know, this requires yet more resources, because it steps into a very new area. So just wanted to make those two points. Thank you.
OK. Liam, I think you've got some questions.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. One of the things the committee felt would help both the coordination and the provision of skills would be a what's now being called a climate intelligence service. Now, we've heard from the government that COSLA, the Improvement Service, and the government are in active discussions around establishing this, and the government has told us that they plan to establish it later this year. So, a series of questions around the Climate Intelligence Service. Are you in a position yet to tell us when that is likely to be operational, where it will be, and how local authorities will draw down on the facilities available?
Yeah, the Climate Intelligence Service is quite an exciting piece of work, I think, Liam, and thanks for the question. We've actually got a report going to leaders on Friday to get their agreement to progress with that, because obviously there's a funding implication as well. Scottish Government have confirmed that they would fund 50% over the next few years towards the cost of setting that up. And I think what's exciting about it is that it will be done in conjunction with Edinburgh University and academics. And what we'll then be able to do is gather real data from all 32 authorities into a single space, and then we'll be able to really analyse that data and look at good shared practice and benchmarking, and we'll have a sort of one-stop shop for what needs to be done across Scotland. So I think it will be a really, really good piece of work. As far as the rolling out, obviously we need agreement of leaders on Friday, but I would hope that they would agree to that, particularly given that Scottish Government have agreed to their end of the deal. But I think what we do need at the moment is rich data, because we have sort of a wee bit of a scattergun. We have different data coming from different authorities. It's feeding into different areas. And I think if we end up with this one-stop shop, we'll have a clearer assistance in a roadmap almost, and then more importantly on the delivery. But I don't know, maybe Silke wants to add a wee bit to that.
Yes, happy to come in, absolutely supporting 100% of what you're saying, and we would actually be, you know, delighted to be able to get the service up and running this year.
I'm very grateful, Gail, you correctly predicted my follow-up question on cost. And you talked about the Scottish Government is funding 50% to the cost of setting up. So do we know yet how much it's going to cost to set up, what the ongoing running costs are? And you said the Scottish Government will fund 50%. So who's going to fund the other 50%, and who's going to fund the ongoing costs?
Silke will have accurate costings in front of her. I don't have them in front of me, but from memory, it's the same amount per year. So this would be a part year, so it wouldn't be the full cost in this year. I think it's about 1.6 million per year, is
it? I think for the first year, we're looking at around about the 1 million mark. And obviously that will take into account the setting up of the service. I think one of the key things that we're trying to do, again, is align the resources that exist in this space. So it's very much a co-production between stakeholders here, my colleagues at Edinburgh University, building on the Place-Based Climate Action Network, which was a research project that had resource behind it. The other thing that's playing into this space, I think, is the longevity of funding and stability. So at the moment, we're talking about almost like a, you know, £1 million sort of setup scenario. But the question is, how do we build and prove the value of the service moving forward? The SSN steering groups received presentations on the CIS, and colleagues here would be very much involved in the process of steering that project and moving it forward. And the critical thing for me is that the beneficiaries of the service actually have a process to feed in and sort of co-design that and co-develop it. So that would be the SSN members working at the sharp end, like David.
So just to be clear, in terms of who's going to be doing this operationally? Mm. So is this, going back to my earlier question, is this going to be based in Edinburgh then? and it, who is it going to be staffed by? Is this, are these new posts that you recruit for, or are these being transferred in, let's say, from other council areas?
Yeah, I don't know. I'm partly looking at Silk, because Silk has been closer to the actual discussions about the proposal in terms of how it's going to be kind of put into operation. But at the moment, it's a combination of, I think the key stakeholders are the Improvement Service, which is an established sort of improvement service for local government. That would be one of the obvious routes to take this. And the other key stakeholder is Edinburgh University, who were the sort of, I suppose we were the sort of brains behind the sort of the notion of having this sort of collective service. In some senses, it's a scaling up of what the SSN's done over the years, but with a very distinct focus around the area-wide agenda. I think the thing that I'm aware of in terms of the committee's interest is how we translate from the data to the plans to the investment, and how do we get to that point of actually shifting the dial on delivery on the ground. So I think the project has to get up and running. We'll go through that whole process of establishing it, recruiting staff, you know, security of employment, etc. That'll all play into it. But at the moment, I think it's looking like Edinburgh base with those key stakeholders.
And just a final question for me, just which arises from the Deputy Convener's question earlier. So the remit of the CIS will be to, as it says, to help councils reach net zero and embed climate impact. But we've heard just now about the importance of the private capital to enable this. So do you anticipate the remit of the CIS actually being about helping to leverage private capital as well?
I would think so. I think we need to get up and running in terms of looking at the data and planning, so we're clearer in terms of what we're looking at in terms of delivery across Scotland. But I think the ambition in terms of the stakeholders, including ourselves, is to take very much a systems approach to this challenge, and not assume that we can do just data to the public sector and things will radically change. So I think it has to play into that. How do we actually shift the systems in this space and opening up that conversation? I think to the private sector, but also to the community sector. Mm-hmm. And we've heard from the Minister there is an investment at the community level. The SSM members in local government are looking at how do we actually make good value from the, I think it's 4.3 million going into community hubs. The last thing I would say about the CIS is there is a regional component to that. So your question about are all the staffs going to be based in Edinburgh, that's not the intention. So there is the notion that we'd have a sort of regional component to this.
Very good. I'm very grateful. Thank you.
Thanks, Liam. Mark, you want to come in briefly?
A thought on the back of that about how this then works with the Scottish Government's Energy Agency, and has there been any discussions? Because obviously the Energy Agency is being set up right now. There's opportunity to maybe align around.
I think one of the critical things that we'd probably all say is alignment. I think we've, you know, in terms of scale and pace, we need to get the alignment to happen. However that comes about, I think the Energy Agency, but also things like LHEIS, you know, we've got people in local government and the wider public sector looking at heat decarbonisation, and that needs to be, again, a place-based systems approach. The CIS has to play into that, and the last thing we need is a CIS which sort of sits in a bubble and doesn't interact. So it's quite a rapidly moving landscape. I think we're all challenged about keeping up to speed with the policy agenda and the various funding streams that exist. But I think the CIS and the stakeholders behind it have to play into that sort of that ecosystem and make sure that it's better aligned.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Thanks.
Thank you. The next questions come from Ash. Hopefully online.
Good morning, committee. Thanks, convener. And good morning to the panel as well. So we've spoken a little bit this morning already about the New Deal. So my questions are primarily around funding and particularly ring fencing. I'm wondering what effect you think that the New Deal will have on levels of ring fencing.
Thanks very much for the question. And as some of you will know, my previous 5 years in my role at COSLA was in the finance role, so I'll probably take this one. I think the key thing through the New Deal, as you can imagine, is that we're working very hard to try and get multi-year settlements. And I think if we can get that stability within local government, it will enable us to do better longer-term planning as well. And I think that that's one thing that we've had as a problem for a number of years is short-termism and the inability to invest over a longer period of time. I think the other aspect to funding is that we've had a drip feed of a lot of bid funds, which again, you know, make it easy for larger authorities that have the skills and the capacity within them to apply and bid into those bid funds, but it puts the smaller authorities that don't have that capacity at a disadvantage. So I think our other ask through the new partnership and the new deal would be that we have less bid funds, we have more, you know, totality pots which are designed for specific things, and then the funding is given to local authorities through an agreed distribution model, and we have a tried and tested model with that. So I think the key thing for us in terms of funding is stability of funding, longevity of funding, and an assurance that years 4 and 5 will be funded, and we're not left. So my hope would be that we'll see less ring fencing, and I think that to achieve our goals on this, it will be absolutely essential. I don't know if you have a view, David, from an officer's perspective.
Yeah, I would agree with that, Councillor McGregor, and I think it comes back to my colleague George's point about, you know, just having the data through the Climate Intelligence Service does not mean action that will happen. Similarly, ring fencing does not necessarily automatically mean that investment will happen, because there is then an impact on other local government funding in terms of other services that are provided. And I think there is also a question here of chicken and egg, and around all of the threads across this landscape are sort of emerging as we speak, and it's a rapidly moving landscape. And I think one of the key things for me that we need to understand first is the scale of that financial gap that's required. And then we can enter into discussions subsequently about the best means of being able to fund that.
OK, thank you. So if I'm picking up that correctly there, can I sort of summarise that COSLA's view, excuse me, of ring fencing, particularly in areas such as net zero goals, maybe isn't entirely appropriate, that you'd like to see less ring fencing there. You can correct me if I haven't got that, you know, if I'm summarising you incorrectly. But, you know, if that is the case, and if, you know, ring fencing isn't as desirable in these areas, how then would you suggest that Scottish Government and local government work together, obviously, to achieve those shared national priorities, particularly on things like net zero, without ring fencing? What would be your suggestions there?
I think we need to differentiate between ring fencing and targeted spend for particular things. And we all know that education has a large budget, as does social care and others. What we're hoping to do, particularly through the Climate Intelligence Service and all the work that's going on elsewhere, is assist in developing this roadmap. And I think once we've got the roadmap and we know where we're going on the journey and what needs done, as an example, Active Travel, I think it has a £1.7 billion fund over the period of this Parliament. We don't know where that's going to be spent yet, or we don't know where the totality is going to be spent yet. The crucial thing for us is not saying that we ring-fence funding for specific things, but that we know what journey we're going on and then how much that will cost. And I think that would be a better way of doing it. As you know, there's been initiatives come through government where a specific pot of money has been allocated to it, and once we've done all the legwork at local authority level, that's not been enough to deliver it, and they've had to then reel back slightly. So I think the challenge is not ring fencing, it's establishing the cost of delivery in partnership.
Just very briefly on that, I think the flip side of taking away ring fence funding is making sure that there's a corporate and political commitment to outcomes. And I think a lot of the conversation in the SSN and at the steering group, which is local government and the wider public sector, is about how do we actually align around outcomes and be less ring fenced in terms of particular challenge funds for projects. Yeah. That comes with an issue which is about, like I say, political and corporate leadership and a clear plan which can be audited and scrutinised. And you know, we've seen the audit kind of regime within the public sector sort of step up on climate change. We would welcome that. We do collaborate with Audit Scotland's ESS are speaking at the SSN conference tomorrow, so we're very keen to make sure that the funding does become aligned to the outcomes that we're trying to achieve.
Sorry, just before we go back to Ash, I mean, my problem is it's a bit of chicken and egg, isn't it? You don't want it ring-fenced, and you're going to give an assurance that it's going to be paid to the right direction, providing this long-term funding. And the government surely will just come back and say they want it ring-fenced, and and there will be a long-term funding. How do, or is that an oversimplification, George?
I don't know. On one level, might defer to colleagues who are a little bit closer to this on the ground, but certainly within the SSN, there is a desire to be far more sort of outcomes-focused and a lot of reference to the Christie Commission principles and preventative spend, and trying to look at climate change as not just a cost, but also an opportunity. So again, tomorrow at the conference, we've got a lot of conversation about public health benefits. So I think there's a more sort of systems approach and sophisticated way of looking at the costs and benefits around climate action. But at the end of the day, we do need to see the public sector sort of saying we are clear in terms of the outcomes. Some of those are very measurable around emissions reductions, have a clear plan for delivery, and then have a conversation about how is this going to be paid for. And that definitely goes beyond public sector spend. We're not going to be, you know, purely spending our way out of this problem through public sector expenditure.
Sorry, Ash, I jumped in. I apologise. Back to you.
Not at all, Convener. That's covered my area of questioning. Thank you.
Thank you very much. The next questions then will come from Mark Ruskell. Mark.
Yeah, thanks. Can I turn to fiscal levers and what the discussion is within COSLA about adopting potentially new fiscal levers to bring in finance? And I'm interested in what areas are being discussed. So transport demand management is an obvious one, but potentially waste, potentially, you know, land management, other areas. It'd be interesting to know where COSLA is at on those issues.
Maybe defer to David and Silke on some specific detail. Obviously, COSLA is working through its fiscal framework at the moment, and the resources spokesperson will be dealing with that. And it's certainly looking at other ways of bringing in some more contentious than others, as you can imagine. But I don't know specifically in terms of transport, David.
Yeah, happy to make some comments, Councillor McGregor, and I'm sure Silke will want to join in as well, particularly around the kind of fiscal side of things in terms of levers. One comment that I would make in response to Mr. Ruskell's question is a couple of good examples there, public transport and waste. And I think a local authority view would be that fiscal levers need to go hand in hand, again, with investment and making sure that what we're actually trying to encourage people in terms of the behaviours for them to adopt, the alternative is in place. So, for example, if we are introducing fiscal levers around demand management of transport, are the alternatives there? And is the infrastructure there in place that that's a reasonable alternative and an affordable alternative for people, whether that's public transport, electric vehicles, etc., or active travel indeed? And similarly for waste, that Silke and I have had previous conversations in different roles around this, around the infrastructure being in place where people have recycling facilities that are clear, that they have robust arrangements for collection of waste, etc., and they can make the right behavioural decisions that we're seeking them to do in response to those levers. Silke, is there anything you would want to...
Yes, no, thank you very much. I think it's been very, very well outlined. I think it is, again, fair to say that there's a huge amount of work going on in the local government family around sort of like what the concrete instruments would be, what financial levers would be, what, you know, legislative levers would be, anything from, you know, workplace parking levies to other instruments. So I think there's a growing focus by the local government family of what the tools would be that would be required to help with this change. But it is also going back to, we need to keep the overall view of the whole system transformation. And that's where we're coming back to what you, Convener, very early on referred to as the local government empowerment, that that local authorities have the ability to draw on these levers as and when they're needed. So I would say there's a very active discussion developing here, and they will be crucial. To which extent, you know, individual financial levers will be needed is something we will probably have more clarity on in the next sort of like 12 months.
I mean, it would be interesting to know if there is a point where, you know, there'll be an ambitious sort of conclusion to that. I'm reminded by the first, reflecting back on the first inquiry that was ever done in the Scottish Parliament in 2005 into climate change, there was a recommendation that ministers should bring forward a workable system of road user charging by 2015. So that was 10 years, nothing happened. You know, we're now years on from that. So You're saying within the next year there'll be a clear view from COLSA about new fiscal levers that can be used, and that will be a clear ask to government about where, you know, they could potentially be extended? Or
It's very much a work in progress, as you can imagine. That I do co-chair the National Transport Strategy as well with a new minister, so that will be a different dynamic. And we've certainly been looking at things like vehicle charging in cities and rural areas, various types, various ways of doing that. The crucial thing for me as a local councillor and for yourselves as locally as elected members is that we have to take our communities with us. And what we are finding, I think, quite a lot at community level is, when EV charging points are rolled out in a community, they go down like a lead balloon sometimes. So, because people, I think 13% of the population have electric vehicles. So a huge percentage don't or don't have cars at all. So what we need to do as elected members is take our communities with us. And when we look at things like vehicle charging, make sure it's done in a way that's more carrot than the stick. And I think that would be our priority sort of within COSLA. That behavioural change is going to be really important if we're going to be a bit more punitive on people to make them change their lifestyles. So that's another piece of work that we're doing at a community level within place planning as well. It's not just about what we're doing at a higher level, it's are we taking our communities with us? And we have found that projects that are developed from the community up are brilliant, that they are really well received, but projects that are imposed upon communities don't go down so well. So I think we're all on a bit of a journey at the moment.
Yeah, okay, that's useful. Can I just move on to city-region deals? A number of these deals were, worked out, 7, 8 years ago? The world's quite different now. The climate emergency is getting more severe. The targets are in place now for 2030, which are very stretching. You alluded to that in your opening remarks, Councillor McGregor. So, are these regional deals still fit for purpose? Is there a point where they need to be looked at again in individual projects? For example, Sheriff Hall perhaps might not meet a carbon test now, or maybe it would. But, who's looking, who's doing that analysis and assessment?
Yeah, COSLA hasn't been directly involved in any of the city deal creation or borderlands or the rural growth deals. It's not an area that COSLA has been directly involved with, but obviously local authorities have. And I think it's fair to say I've just recently taken over as leader of Dumfries and Galloway, and we're doing a scan of our capital investment strategy because we know that quite a lot of the infrastructure projects that have been on the list for 5 or 10 years are probably obsolete and really need a refocus. And I would expect that borderlands and city deals would be doing the same. Obviously, we had local elections last year, so we'll have 32 councils who are probably, certainly we've already agreed ours, developing their 5-year council plans, and that will be a very different looking plan to the 5 years previously. So certainly within ours, the economy and the environment are much more embedded as a priority than they were in the previous 5 years. So I would hope that councils individually, but I can't speak on behalf of COSLA, will be doing exactly that, because I know that I certainly am.
Yeah, that's good to hear. And then lastly, I was going to ask you about community and third sector partnerships. I mean, I suppose that the deal that you're striking with Scottish Government, the third sector would say needs to be replicated with councils as well in developing new partnerships. The government, in response to this inquiry, has announced additional funding into climate hubs to scale up the ambition of what a third sector can achieve in communities and make a huge difference. I'm just wondering what your thinking is, what your approach is. That is there a commitment from local authorities to work with those climate hubs, and where do you see the third sector?
George, you want to pick up on the climate hubs?
I would say certainly through the SSM, there's definitely the appetite, the interest, very, very keen to align. I think there can be kind of bumps along the road in terms of, often a gap between a local authority or public sector approach to climate change and communities. So a lot of our work is about trying to build those bridges and create the space for our own members to have the conversation about how do we get the community sort of investment and energy aligned to the scaling up. You know, I think a lot of community projects can be fantastic, but they do face the challenge of their own sustainability and the scale of impact. And you'll note from a range of examples across Scotland where they can be fantastic at a local, very local level. But the challenge is how do we sort of scale up in terms of regional and link into some of those kind of national agendas. And we're all faced with that scale and pace issue. So speaking on behalf of the SSN and SSN members, and we've got a conversation coming up in June just to create the space for our own members to say how are things playing out across Scotland, what's the experience so far, and how can we help with the, again, the alignment and coordination. So.
Okay, yeah. The convener just and add to what George has shared there. I think it again comes back to resources, sorry to mention that word again, and local authorities' ability to work with communities. However, on a positive, there are organisations like Keep Scotland Beautiful that increasingly local authorities are working together with, so they have initiatives including climate action towns, a number of pilot settlements across Scotland to sort of develop a community-based approach to tackling climate change. They also provide support to local authorities around developing with communities community climate action plans as well. And these, I think, are the kind of models across the local government family that we will need to increasingly look at over the next 12 to 24 months to really embed action within communities and work with communities to understand, as Councillor McGregor referred to earlier, what their particular priorities are in terms of climate change, what the particular challenges are within those communities, and how then we as local authorities work as enablers to help them deliver that and to help enable behaviour change, etc. So there are frameworks and models out there, Mr Ruscoe, that I think local authority will increasingly draw upon to come up with proposals in terms of how we work with community and third
sector.
There's
a lot of good practice, and I think we heard quite a lot of that during the inquiry. So.
Thank you very much, Mark. The next questions come from Monica.
Thank you, convener, and good morning to the panel. I want to pick up on transport. You will know that in our inquiry report, the committee supported stronger regional transport partnerships models to try and get a more joined up and strategic approach to public transport and active travel at the regional level. And the panel's talked a lot about alignment today, which is good to hear. I'm just wondering what additional powers or resources do regional transport partnerships need to plan and deliver effective regional public and active transport systems?
Gosh, really good question. George is desperate.
No,
don't all speak at once.
The question: Who wants to go with that? David.
Yeah, happy to comments in response to Ms Lennon's questions. It's back to that systems approach, and I think that has never been more apparent than people gradually making a transition, for example, to electric vehicles. I think the regional transport partnership approach, Ms Lennon, is going to look very different across the country when we're in somewhere like Edinburgh, where we can really encourage people to potentially move away from private car, and we've increasingly put infrastructure in place to enable people to do that. Whereas in our more kind of rural and island geographies, clearly the landscape is very different, and people will have a reliance on private cars. So it's about how we help, again, co-produce solutions that suit different environments, and how we do that through regional transport partnerships, and about how we improved how joined up our transport systems are. And I think the challenges are increasing now with, for example, people moving to EVs have a lower range generally, so they have to plan journeys more clearly, or they maybe have different modes that they're using. They'll drive to a certain point, pick up a public transport node. And I think also post-COVID and agile working, etc., that has completely shifted the dynamics of how we travel, not just in this country, but elsewhere as well. But I think coming back to your question, regional transport partnerships will absolutely be a key partner, and there will be, I think, different focus and priorities in different parts of the country about how we respond to that.
Thank you for that, David. I know electric vehicles have been mentioned a couple of times, but we know that the government's target is to reduce car kilometres by 20% by the end of this decade. And we had a debate in Parliament last week about buses and the role of bus services. But we've seen a big reduction in both passenger journeys and the number of bus services over quite a long period of time. So I'm just wondering how confident are you that bus partnerships and the bus partnership fund will increase bus patronage across Scotland regions, and how might these arrangements be improved?
I think transport has been highlighted, I think, locally and nationally as one of the biggest levers for us achieving these goals. And I think one of the challenges that we do have is that obviously some of the routes are driven by profit. And if the routes are not viable, it then turns to the local authority to pick up the slack on that. As an example, it would take you 14 hours to get from Eyemouth to Stranraer by public transport. So, you know, across the south of Scotland, public transport is a massive, massive challenge. And I think what we need to be looking at when we're re-tendering bus contracts locally and we're looking at the routes that are required is, are they fit for this transport transition to a cleaner way of working? It's really challenging, particularly in rural areas, much more straightforward in urban areas, I would say. But George, you might have something to add.
Just a very quick sort of supplementary to that. We've, through the SSN, helped support the establishment of a new climate leadership group. So it's leaders within the public sector sort of coming together on a more regular basis, and they had a focus on the transport issue just at the last meeting, both the kind of broad scale, the reduction of car kilometres, and then what we actually do as public sector bodies to sustain the sort of travel benefits of the impact of the pandemic, you know, making sure that we don't go back to sort of old ways of working. So the Climate Leaders Group is certainly looking at the transport issue. The other reference point for the SSN is the work that the Scottish Government's promoted over the years around behaviour change using the individual social material model. And we find that very, very useful, not just for behaviour change, but to, again, think systematically about the work that could be done in this place. So even just on a related issue in terms of bus transport, there is the kind of social dimension to this, the just transition element, and sort of picking up on campaigns. You know, I know the kind of Love My Bus campaign was active recently. Just there's a role for the public sector just sort of picking up on some of that communication and public engagement kind of role. So we would be looking at sort of promoting some of those issues.
You've just reminded me, George, I think this is Love My Bus Week. I think my colleague Mark Busco might be promoting an event in Parliament this week. So that's a reminder to colleagues. I know that the Deputy Convener has questions on this topic as well, but you know, carrots and sticks have been mentioned a couple of times in behaviour change. So, you know, we have a big opportunity with more people able to access the national travel concessionary scheme, you know, the free bus pass now for 22-year-olds and under. But some areas in Scotland we're hearing about emerging bus deserts where there are no or very few bus services. So I just wonder to what extent are you seeing a renewed appetite for people to use bus, and is there an appetite with our councils to, you know, get stuck in and to basically run and operate municipal bus companies? Because we know about the powers in the Transport Act, we know about those levers, but the conversations that we have sometimes with local government is that, oh, but we don't have the funds, oh, but, you know, we don't have that capacity. Is there a willingness, or is it just going to be too difficult?
I think there's an absolute willingness, and I'm not going to repeat the funding and all the other challenges sort of within that. The reality is that if we want people to come out of their cars and reduce car miles by 20%, we have to offer, as Scotland, not just local authorities, government, everybody, an exemplary public service, public transport service. And we need to look to other countries and other cities that have that in place. Amsterdam would be a prime example. There's a multitude of ways how you can get around Amsterdam. At the moment, it's half the price to travel a car mile than it is to travel a bus mile. So what incentive is there for people to get out of their cars if they have a service? So the other thing I think we do need to look at particularly is the linkages between bus service and road connecting to rail service and other areas of transport. Because what we have at the moment is a slightly disjointed system where the bus, as an example, from Lockerbie to Dumfries to Lockerbie arrives 10 minutes after the train leaves to go to Edinburgh. Now, that, you know, it's simple things like that at local level that I think there's a real willingness to try and improve, but it will ultimately come down to service need and funding.
Okay, I'm happy to like.
Just before Fiona, sorry, yeah, just sorry. Before you go on, just a quick question on that. And I've noticed it's said a couple of times during this meeting, improving the bus services in urban areas. They can be as good as you like in urban areas, but if those people who live in rural areas can't get in to the urban areas, they're actually pretty much useless to those people. So how are you going to take the rural areas along with this ambition if they lack the services?
You're absolutely right. I had to drive up this morning because the 7:10 train from Lockerbie was not running. So, you know, I've had to do a two-hour drive, and that's not a good thing. So we need to look at the totality of transport across Scotland and how it interlinks. Now, obviously, we have challenges with, you know, north of the border, south of the border services, and the ScotRail and English services, and it's very challenging. But if we don't, as you say, sort out that connectivity from rural to urban, we're only solving half the problem, I would say.
And I would love to come in by train every morning on a Tuesday morning, but as long as I'm happy to arrive after this committee's started, that's possible. There were quite some cheers of excitement there. Before, on that basis, I'll move to the Deputy Convener, yes. Fiona.
It's just still on the issues of connectivity and that point about who organises this and who should organise this, because it seems to be a bit of a pass the parcel between individual local authorities, regional transport partnerships, and I'm not even sure Transport Scotland has a role in this, or you could tell me otherwise. So, you know, if you take what, you know, my constituency area in West Lothian, semi-rural, but you could take a lot of cars off roads if there was better connectivity in relation to towns and park and ride. And, you know, you can see that what's happening with Fife into Edinburgh, for example. There's so much focus on the cities, but we've got, in this region, we've got East Lothian, we've got Mid Lothian, we've got West Lothian. But that seems to be a bit of a disconnect, and that really needs coordination. So what is happening to try and change that? Is there something that can be done with regional transport partnerships to give them real targets of what they need to do? And who are they accountable to? And how do we get that, exactly the coordination that Councillor McGregor was talking about?
Yeah. Happy to take that question, Ms Hislop. I think it's a real challenge, and what you've outlined there, I think, is a really accurate assessment of the landscape across transport, and it touched on Ms Lennon's points as well, just about roles and responsibilities between regional transport partnerships, SPT, Transport Scotland, local authorities, and indeed commercial providers. And it is quite a mixed landscape. We have had legislative changes to provide additional opportunities to local authorities, and as Councillor McGregor has said, we're very much a willing partner in that, but again, it comes back to resources. We don't have resources to run services that are not viable commercially, and they're not viable commercially for a reason, because they're not profitable, and then there is a subsidy issue and about where that funding comes from, let alone the skills and expertise required in order to operate those. So it absolutely is a challenge. There has been a willingness, and I know even in my own authority, municipal bus services is an option that I've been involved in personally, but not without its challenges. But I think back to Ms Hislop's question and the points that we've made around systems thinking. This is about part of the reset of relationships across stakeholders, Scottish Government, local government, other partners, including transport stakeholders as well, about what is it we're actually envisioning, what is it that we want the country to look at, what is our baseline position, and how do we get from here to there? And part of that will be a refresh, I think, and reset of roles and responsibilities and more alignment and more clarity. But we also need to be realistic. There will be some public transport services that aren't viable. So in those rural areas, we can't make the country completely connected by public transport. That's not a realistic vision. There wouldn't be the patronage to do that. And it's, I think, back to what I mentioned earlier about bespoke solutions in different areas, and about a toolkit or a menu of transport options. And one point, lastly, that we haven't touched on is indeed community transport as well, which is emerging as communities again take action into their own hands in terms of providing some essential services they require.
And leading on, therefore, to my next question is about local franchises. Which could be either community, I'm assuming, and again, this issue, how to support them, and the Bus Partnership Fund. And what is your understanding of the interrelationship between those to meet the step change that we need? Because, you know, £500 million is a lot of money to go into to help support local authority bus, either local franchises or indeed community-owned buses. But how do we lever that in? Because it seems to be most councils just now are just under scoping kind of exercises within that. So what do you think is going to happen, or what do you want to happen to help, you know, make sure that local franchises can, one, exist but also are funded? And do you think the Bus Partnership Fund can do that?
Happy to come back in on that question, Ms Hislop. I think one of the challenges is around regulation. So it's really daunting to actually provide services in a different way, because the regulation that is around the system is rightly so robust and complex. So there are various regulation requirements from the Traffic Commissioner, various permits that communities need to engage with if they want to provide community transport in accordance with the legislation. And I think that can sometimes be intimidating or daunting in terms of innovative solutions around the legalities, and then how franchise solutions or community transport solutions sit in juxtaposition with commercial provision, because it's about meeting a gap and not providing necessarily competition where there's a viable commercial alternative. So again, I think that comes back to the learning journey that we're on collectively about trying to find innovative transport solutions. But I do think one of the barriers around that, or one of the challenges to get to grips with, is regulation, which could be an area to look at in terms of how we would stimulate more franchise provision and community transport provision.
I could just check, where would the Bus Partnership Fund sit within a New Deal discussion with local government if the Bus Partnership Fund is to help fund local councils?
I'm not entirely sure.
Yeah, that's a question I think we need to take
come
away.
Back on, yeah.
Okay, if you could do that.
We'll do that, absolutely. Okay.
Monica, very briefly.
Sticking with funding, so there's also the Community Bus Fund. Scottish Government has funded that to the tune of £1 million, but that, again, is across 32 local authorities. So what is being achieved from that sum of money? You know, and if there's more than £1 million available, what could be done? It doesn't seem like a lot.
Yeah, I think, again, it's emerging, Ms Lennon. I think there's a real appetite from local authorities to work with communities, because certainly the feedback, again, from personal involvement earlier this year with some community engagement sessions, transport is absolutely a challenge, and that is the feedback from communities about how they get from A to B. So we do have a toolkit, some options out there in terms of funds and access. I've mentioned already some of the challenges around regulation, but I think local government, we are absolutely looking to work with communities and take advantage of these funds and get schemes and creative options for provision of transport up and running. So I think we're at early stages. Speaking from, again, to draw on my own authority example, we're looking at a community transport option with an existing community transport provider, literally as we speak, and about how we widen that out to help respond to some of the challenges that have been fed back to us in terms of gaps in provision across my own authority area. So there's a real appetite there from community transport providers. There's an appetite from local authority. There's an appetite from communities. There's funding there to help with that. So I think we will see progress in terms of that community.
Just a really quick point of clarity, that £1 million community bus fund, is that being shared equally between the 32 local authorities, or do you all get a different share?
I'm not entirely sure, Ms Lennon, in terms of the allocation of the fund, whether it's pro rata or distribution.
Okay.
Thank you.
OK. Jackie, I think you've got some questions.
Yes, thank you. My questions is going to be regarding the HEAT programmes, if you don't mind. In response to the committee's report, the Scottish Government stated that it's working to embed local heat and energy efficiency strategies and area-based approaches across its heat decarbonisation programme. Can I ask what in practice does this mean? And what is the Scottish Government doing to make sure that it is embedded?
It's a portfolio with a lot of acronyms, isn't it? I'll defer to George on this, because I think that...
Yeah, and again, probably Silke and David are close to this as well, but certainly from an SSM perspective, our members are involved both through SSN and the Energy Officers Network, everything from establishing LHEIS officers to starting to do the planning, starting to do the zoning. So that a lot of it is scaling up in terms of getting to grips with the data, the demand and the plan that needs to be put in place. And I think there are specific targets in terms of having those LHEIS plans in place, I think, by the end of this calendar year. So there are challenges there in terms of just, it takes us back to this issue in terms of systems thinking, tackling things that we've never really had to tackle before, very much working on a place base, not just your corporate estate. So there, I think there's a lot of things just taking place across the country, which is just the challenge of getting the right people in the place to do the job. And actually, the one thing I would say is SSN, the Improvement Service, COSLA, the Energy Officers, very, very active conversations to make sure that we're not duplicating efforts. So I think the other challenge is around contracting. So some of this work will be done by consultants. So, you know, the number of consultants available to do the work at the same time, that is something that we play into this challenge in terms of actually meeting those targets. But
okay. Yeah. And you mentioned about the LHEIS being in place by the end of this year. Are all 32 on track for being in place?
I'll defer to David on that.
Yeah, thanks, Councillor McGregor. I think that would be fair to say. Ms Dunbar, I think on the whole, local government has welcomed LHEIS and the resources that have come with it in order to deliver, and they have been specific. And local government, there are a variety of approaches being taken, whether that is outsourcing for external support to a consultant or indeed insourcing by hiring an LHEIS officer to help with preparation of the strategies and the delivery plan. I think for me, LHEIS at its heart is about systems thinking again and about looking at the geography across a local authority to understand the areas of heat demand and to start to outline through the delivery plan opportunities for decarbonisation and to provide actually, as George said, the data, the intelligence in one place, working across sectors and partners, because it's not just local authority based, it's geography based across the local authority area. So what we would expect to see emerging from that is outline projects for perhaps a new heat network, a new district heating system in an area that has sufficient density and sufficient heat load and heat demand, or, for example, looking at archetypes. So that's a term that has been increasingly common currency. And it comes back to convener, your point about council housing, for example. There are archetypes of council housing that you see, whether you're in one part of the country or another, that all require similar solutions in terms of investment for decarbonisation of heat. Similarly, across our school estate, there are archetypes of school construction from certain periods that whether you're in a school in East Lothian or in Argyll and Bute, they will have a similar construction type and floor plan. So the idea behind LHEIS is about aggregating these archetypes across the local authority area, but also looking more broadly across LHEIS regionally to scale up what we talked about earlier in terms of identifying propositions for investment, including through decarbonisation of heat.
Okay.
Just on that as well, through you, convener, just very briefly. Yeah. I think this is a
Gail, but I think you may upset Silker if you don't bring her in. She's waiting very patiently.
That's fine. I was just going to say that I think LHEIS has been a really good example of co-production, and it was one of the first things that came on my desk last June, and the work that's gone on behind the scenes is clearly going to deliver something on target and on time, which is great. So that was pre-New Deal. So that was all I wanted to say.
And Silke, now's your moment when Gail lets you in.
No, that's it. No, just wanted to confirm to the committee so that you do know. So all 32 local authorities are running in the LHEIS. There's been a long process of sort of like, you know, working with Scottish Government towards making these a useful sort of like instrument. So just to confirm, that is happening by the end of the year. You know, 32 local authorities will have their, you know, strategy more or less in place. Or we'll have them in place. I think what is maybe of interest to the committee here is that the level of collaboration between local government and Scottish Government is much improving in the heat and energy sector. And at the same time, as you will all be aware from looking at the climate change plan, the heat and energy portfolio is one of the key things with a massive challenge. And if we want to meet these hugely ambitious targets, we still have to step up the collaboration, step up the co-production, step up the resourcing in all of these areas if we want to meet these massive targets.
Is the budget that is in place just now, 2.4 million, do you think that's going to be adequate to deliver it?
Is it enough money?
Yeah, I think in terms of my understanding...
I know that's a...
Yeah, it's a really specific question. I think in terms of my understanding, local government, as I said earlier, have welcomed the additional resource that has been aligned to ELGEs, and colleagues are working within that envelope to deliver the strategies and delivery plans.
OK. The Scottish Government also responded to the report by saying that they are working with wider stakeholders to align the current and future delivery and funding programmes with ELGEs to support a strategic approach to the decarbonisation of heat, reflecting local context and tailoring support to specific needs of communities. With that in mind, can I ask what work is being done to ensure that the current and future programmes are being aligned, and does it reflect the place-based approach that they're wanting to happen?
I can comment briefly on that, and colleagues might have sort of views on it as well. I think it is. I think you certainly get that sense of a kind of place-based approach and not one model fitting everywhere. The other thing I was going to mention was we're trying to do this in a way that's not completely myopic. So we're bringing in expertise from out with Scotland. So again, tomorrow at the conference, we've got a dedicated session on place-based approaches to heat and energy efficiency, and that's pulling on the expertise of the wider UK. So the Energy Systems Catapult colleagues are playing into that conversation. So making sure that we're not just doing it purely in a sort of Scottish context. But in terms of actually the alignment of effort, the other thing I'm just aware of is the role of the network distribution companies, SSEN and SPEN, and I think colleagues in the public sector are very conscious that we can only do heat and energy efficiency measures if the grid responds. And certainly recent conversations have indicated that partly through regulation and partly through a desire, there's more appetite for community engaging with the public sector around how do we actually make these transitions. So again, taking that systems approach, thinking about the material and systems elements to heat and energy efficiency kind of delivery.
Okay. And my final question, don't mind, convener. It was just to ask you what the impact is of pausing the Warmers Homes Scotland scheme. What impact will that have on new applicants?
David or Silke could possibly pick up on that.
Yes, Silke, you're on.
All right, thank you. Yes. I can't answer. I don't want to come in on the sort of like detail of the Warm Home Scheme. I think these are all elements in a big picture. And I think what I wanted to reflect back here is that there is growing integration between different funds, between different initiatives. But I think the central message that we are keen to relay to you is that if we really genuinely want to make the 2030 target, we need to move in this space much faster, much quicker. We can't just go on with business as usual, sort of like trying to find more synergies and a little bit more alignment, but we really need that absolute step change in what we have called for, which is the empowerment of local government, which is the big tickets, the big steps, the big resources for local government to actually be able to create in this place with a lot more flexibility and a lot more impact. But I'll pass the question on the Warm Homes to whoever may wish to answer this specific one.
Well, everyone's ducking.
Yeah, it's not an area that I'm familiar with, but I can get the information to you, absolutely.
Been paused because what they're wanting to come in is with expanded help and maybe some different rules, so I'd have just been keen to find out. If you could get back to me, that'd be great.
Absolutely.
So, sorry, just so I can get to the bottom of that. Gail, are you undertaking to you'll write to the committee with the answers to that specific question and the effects of the pause on it for us to understand that. Mark, you wanted to come in briefly and then I'm going to have to go to the deputy.
Yeah, I was interested in this work on the local heat energy strategies, whether councils are actively considering becoming energy generators, municipally owned energy companies, or are the strategies all about coordinating opportunities locally?
I think, Mr. Ruskell, there's absolutely an appetite from a number of local authorities to become municipal energy generators, including ourselves in North Ayrshire. And there are a number of authorities with projects, energy, renewable energy generation projects, and also heat district heating schemes at various stages of development. And some of the challenges that we've had around that, I think there's been a focus of the committee previously on some of the planning aspects in terms of through the planning process. I think not so much in terms of public sector generation. The issues come back to George's point around grid and grid capacity and timescales and complexity in terms of application processes. But I would like to think that through LHEs, that will be another incentive or encouragement in terms of unlocking some of those barriers, because I do believe that local authorities have a real, and other public sector partners have an absolute role to play in the energy transition and the emerging draft energy strategy and just transition in terms of providing municipal energy generation.
Okay, I want to come to the deputy convener now, who I think has got some questions.
Yes, if we can maybe move on to natural capital. We took evidence, and I recall Highland Council being quite strong in terms of some of their concerns around this area. So what work is being done by local authorities to attract private investment into tackling natural capital and its contribution to our net zero targets? And are there any specific examples where local authorities are working with the Scottish Government or other agencies to realise this?
Do you know examples?
Yeah, I could give a couple and then maybe George will come in. I think that's a particularly emerging area around natural resources and how we work with other partners. There are some examples around the country, off the top of my head, around working with golf course operators and actually then doing joint projects around investment in the habitat and quality of the habitats around golf courses, to help improve biodiversity and have that kind of golf course operation happening side by side. There are also other examples, again, emerging around afforestation and working with commercial forestry providers, etc., around leveraging in private investment for afforestation to help with carbon sequestration, etc. But I think that there's a real developing area in terms of that flip side of reduction of our carbon emissions, but your point, Ms. Hislop, about then what do we do with those residual emissions, and that has to be part of the solution and part of the challenge that we're looking at across the system. George?
I was just going to flag up with the SSM being beyond the public sector, so we've certainly got colleagues in Scottish Water and Nature Scott who could maybe flesh out some further information, which I could bring back to the committee. There's also a natural capital on public sector land working group that's looking at what does the public sector actually own and how do you leverage in whatever resources required to do natural capital projects. And I think around the whole carbon accounting agenda, the public sector is far more aware of that balancing off. Now that we've got the net zero narrative in Scotland, people are looking at emissions reduction, but also the importance of sequestration and the impact on the biodiversity crisis. So again, I'm very aware that COSLA's agenda here is very much the net zero and biodiversity challenges. So, but more than happy to come back to the committee with further information.
If you can, we're also interested in what you see as the advantages and disadvantages and whether you think there's an adequate system of carbon accounting as part of this as well. Because there is, there are advantages and disadvantages in that, and we need a system that kind of works.
Indeed.
But also doesn't end up seeing a situation where everybody's double counting what the carbon sequestration is for private companies that are doing the investment as well as the geographic space, because that would be misleading for everybody.
Yeah, no, absolutely happy to come back on that. And again, I think colleagues in Scottish Water are really sort of pushing the agenda here, and very, very keen through the SSN to sort of share that experience, aware that everything's not worked out in this space, so they've invested in studies trying to put some more flesh on the bones and making sure that the other bits of the public sector are not spending resource to replicate that study.
And then just finally, I mean, the inquiry that we had was about local government and its partners, because we very much see that, as you've just yes. identified, yep. there are a number of partners that have to be in this yep. space to make sure that you can help lead in your yep. or coordinate or facilitate or whatever role yep. in different areas that you may take. Mm-hmm. So looking at the report itself, you've already indicated that the need for that route map is essential. We've very much had that as one of our key recommendations. So that's probably one of the recommendations that you welcomed. Are there any others that you thought were particularly strong that helps you in your agenda? And also, if you can maybe be quite frank with us, are there any of the recommendations that we put forward you think are more challenging and that you might want to have either pushback to us or indeed will cause more of a challenge that you might want to get a question?
I think for us the route map is absolutely the crucial thing. It's pulling all of the strands together across all sectors of what we need to be doing, but that in of itself shouldn't prevent us from doing other things. And myself and the convener have had this conversation that we can't wait for the route map yeah. to start doing things. We have to be doing things, but the route map will put us all on the same path. It will make us understand the scale of the challenge, who needs to be doing what, and how much it will cost. And we said that right at the start. And I think one of the biggest challenges we have is taking our communities with us. You mentioned Keep Scotland Beautiful earlier on, and we've just had Spring Clean, and it's amazing how much energy there is in communities if we engage with them in the first instance and take them with us. So I think for us, the roadmap is incredibly important, but also taking our communities with us.
And if there's any others want to contribute
the
in terms of
stuff,
the recommendations in our report, you're yeah. welcome, but those that yeah. you think perhaps you think might be more challenging for you?
From my perspective, I think the overall sort of tenor of the report was really excellent, as well as the sort of crunchy content that's in the report. I think just you very much were sort of banging the drum of aligning the resources that already exist. We certainly welcome the references to the SSN and working in partnership. And that focus on local government and its partners. The SSN started as a local government network. It's now pan-public sector.
Right.
We run the mandatory reporting, so we'd like to see reporting used more actively to track progress, link it up with the links of the CIS. And I would say the effort that's going in through the SSN at the steering group level, I think you've got practitioner leaders really stepping up into this space, and David's an example of that. I think in terms of the challenges, I think we've covered a lot of them here in the conversation, you know, the finance, the skills, the actual delivery on the yeah. ground, you know, they're the things that are keeping us awake at night. I would say, just in reflection of that, we welcome the challenging issues that are in the report, and the SSN agenda very much reflects a lot of those key issues. If you look at the SSN conference programme just tomorrow, it's all those big challenges, yeah. the strategic issues around skills, finance, governance at a local level. They're the things that the SSN is really spending its time on.
Thank you very much.
Thanks very much. Just before we go, I've got one final question. Sorry, Gail. It's the interest, my interest of bringing in private money to finance some of the things that need to be achieved. Now, with an interest rate, a relatively low interest rate, you could say that we've had in previous years, 4.5% now, maybe increasing, they'll be looking for a return on their money as well. And there will be a significant cost to the people either who benefit from it or the users of the services or to councils. So levering in is fine. Paying for it is the difficult part. Does that make you lose sleep at night as well?
Yeah, happy to. I think the convener, we've talked about a number of challenges this morning, and even some of the solutions are not without their challenges and trade-offs, as you've just outlined. But ultimately, we have to find a route to delivery, and that's not going to come, in my view, without leveraging in private sector investment. That has to absolutely be part of it. And I suppose for me, representing local government, it's about us being the custodians then, and about undertaking that kind of assessment and ensuring that there is really good value for the public pound and that the transition working with our partners is just, and that will look different across different projects. To draw on an example of EV charging that I mentioned earlier, we are looking at a blend of private sector funding, so a concession contractor to come in, along with some public sector funding through an application to Transport Scotland. So through the procurement of that device, if you like, we will absolutely, as the public sector partner, have our eye on the tariffs that that concession contractor is looking to apply. Are they reasonable? Are they affordable for people, etc.? And balancing up against their need to make a commercial return in the project, because that's their prerogative and why they have come to the table. So I think it's about the role that the public sector plays in trying to balance those different challenges on a project-by-project basis.
And I think that will be the interest and the challenge, because we haven't always got it right. I mean, I know Highland Council was subsidising all their charging points so that the people got free or very cheap charging across the Highland Council area just for their electric cars, and other people felt that was wrong. And similarly, we've seen it in other services that we provide, whether it's hospital TV, where people get charged through the nose for that, because we've attracted private finance. And I think my concern is how we balance that and how we let people know who are benefiting from it, that it may cost them something in return, because unless we do, we don't take the communities with us. So I see you nodding, so we're not disagreeing.
It's the entire principle of a just transition to net zero, and I think that that's the crucial word. It has to be just.
Okay. Thank you very much. It's been a really interesting session, and I think it's interesting from the committee's point of view how well our report has gone down, and the fact that you've welcomed it and you're working on it. And I think from all the committee, I'd say that's good news. I'd also say from the committee, Silke, good luck with your healing, and I hope you are back to full fitness shortly. So thank you very much, and I'm going to pause the meeting now before we go into private session while we change over for witnesses. Welcome back, just say that our next item of consideration is a negative instrument, the Heat Networks, Heat Network Zones and Building Assessment Report, Scotland Regulations 2023. The instrument is laid under the negative procedure, which means its provisions will come into force unless the Parliament agrees to a motion to annul them. No motions to annul have been laid. Do any members have any comments on the instruments? No. Therefore, can I invite the committee to agree that it does not wish to make any recommendations in relation to the agreement, to the instrument? We are agreed. Thank you. That concludes our public meeting, and we'll now go into private session.